Καλησπέρα σας. Αρχίζουμε την τέταρτη συνεδρία. Θα ήθελα να ευχαριστήσω και εγώ από την καρδιά μου την κυρία Έλληνα Κόρκα και βεβαίως με τη σημερινή μας συνάντηση, όπως καταλαβαίνετε, ήδη έγινε θεσμός. Αυτό δεν ξέρω πώς θα το πάρει, διότι αυτό είναι μια ευθύνη τώρα ετήσια, θα είναι Biennale, θα είναι πάντως περιμένουμε γιατί έχουν ανοίξει πάρα πολλά θέματα. Θα ήθελα να καλέσω, Λοιπόν, θα ήθελα να καλέσω τον κύριο Καστρίτσιο Ελίγιο Ντανιέλε να μας πει για τους myth of Aeneas, arrival in Latium, in the ancient coin times. Να σημειώσω μόνο ότι θα τελειώσει η μετάφραση, άρα όσοι έχουν ακουστικά θα πρέπει να τα μεταφέρουν, να τα δώσουν πίσω και βεβαίως στις 7 η ώρα, 7 με 7.30 το αργότερο. Ευχαριστώ πολύ.
Κυρίες και κύριοι, good afternoon, we are here. The older representation of Aeneas in coins is recorded in the myth of Enium, located 15 miles from Thessalonica, a series of tetrapods from the beginning of the 5th century before Christ shows the head of the Trojan Myron, considered as the founder of the city, with the Corinthian helmet typical of the Greek warrior of the epic poet. In the 4th century before Christ, the city changed the iconography of the mythical founder, pointing out its Asian origin, simply replacing the Corinthian helmet with a Phrygian one. In Rome, which considered Aeneas as responsible for the settlement of the Trojans in Latium, the coin types during the Republican period are concentrated on the hero's flight from Troy while carrying his father Anchises, a symbol of the pietas on his shoulder. The itinerant mint of Caesar, who coined many denarii, shows it to us with his father in the act of transporting Palladium from Troy to the Latium. Palladium was considered one of the pignora imperii which guaranteed the invincibility of Rome. Caesar iconography was taken up by Octavian, who, when wanting to emphasize the pietas toward his father, the Divus Caesar, excluded Palladium from the coin representation. In the same years, in Segesta, in the Roman province of Sicily, the type of Aeneas, Anchises, and Palladium is resumed to emphasize the same Trojan ancestry of the Romans and the Hellenians. A very accurate depiction of the myth is found in a bronze coin from the period of Severi with Aeneas, harmed as Greek hero, the father, and Ascanius Iulus, dressed as a Phrygian with the Eastern tiara. The same iconography has many archaeological comparisons, among which we point out the marble relief from Carthage commissioned by a freedman named Edulus. A brief digression is necessary at this point to show, through an exemplary case, the idea of departure and arrival to and from a place using a ship. The clearest example concerns the movement of the mint from Ostia to Arelate in the years 313-314 AD by order of the Emperor Constantine. The transfer of the workshop is witnessed by two bronze coins minted in Arelate. In the first, you see the personification of the mint identified by the Libra and the Cornucopia on a boat, which moves away from a personification of Rome. In the other one, we see the same mint that arrives at Arelate, represented by Hercule Tichipolios. The bow of the ship in the first issue is shown on the opposite side of the personification of Rome. In the second coin, instead, you can see the probe that heads towards the Tichipolios of the city. departure and arrival are made clear only by the direction of the ship. We still find the same iconographic expedient in a bronze coin of the time of Severus Alexander, in which we see the scene of the departure of Aeneas and Ascanius with a ship ready to sail the anchors, of which we see only the stern. The ship of Aeneas can be recognized in the reverse side of the silver statue of the myth of Lefkas, dated in the 2nd century before Christ, where we see to the right the representation to Aphrodite Aeneas, whose cult, according to the sources, was implanted on the Ionian island by the same hero, while he was heading into the Latium. Coming to the theme of Aeneas arriving in Latium, we found the first reference in the Roman series known by the numismatists as Gold of the Oath, because it presents a scene with three characters on the reverse. In the center, we see Faunus, who carries a pig in its arms. On the left, we have a man with a long beard and a baldeum on his left shoulder, holding a spear. On the right, a beardless man with armor and a stapura, with the tip pointing downwards. The two standing men have their sword drawn on the piglet. It is evidently a scene of an oath, with the ritual sacrifice of little pig, of which we have many traces in archaeological, literary, and numismatic sources. Regarding the coins, we can point out the bronze sextants on the myth of Atella in Campania, with warriors with drawn sword and a piglet in the middle of them. Later, we find an identical representation of that in the gold coin on the reverse side of the Roman denarius of 137 BC, in which the magistrates Presbyter Titus Vetulius, descendant of the Vetulius defeated at Caudium in 321 BC, recorded the ancestral alliance between Romans and Italians. The upper side of the coin shows a head of Mars with a Corinthian helmet characterized by pinne, the sign of the Italic military command. In 106 before BC, a series of denarii coined by the magistrate Gaius Sulpicius shows on the reverse two warriors armed with spears with a pig between them. On the obverse, we have two beardless heads with diadems identified with many dance, like those of the Penates of the Dioscuri. During the Bello Sociale, around the year 90 BC, we find two denarii of the Italic insurgents showing on out the hot scene. The first one presents a revival of both the coin titles of obverse and reverse used by Titus Vetulius, with only one substantial modification. The warriors with the sword stipend now are not two, but four, in order to make the scene of the hot consistent with the present moment in which many Italic peoples are allies in order to fight against Rome. In this regard, we must note that the issuing authority used a previous iconographic model, reading it in a totally different context. The scene that showed the Roman ancestral and Rome's ancestral link with the Italics is now used to propagate the sworn pact that binds the Italic enemies of Rome. In the second denarius, we see on the reverse a scene of Otto on a pig in which the warriors are eight. While the obverse side, you can recognize the head of the personification of Italy. Returning to the gold series of the hot, we must note that despite the precious and, in our humble opinion, decisive study of Andrea Salfeldi, the majority of scholars disbelieve that this is a generic voting scene between Romani and Italici, or a specific reference to the pact between the Samnites and the Romans after the humiliation of the Fosse Caudine. Although we didn't find any scientific motivation for this theory, we believe to understand this the justification that lies behind this hypothesis. In the aforementioned denarius of Titus Vetulius, we saw a similar scene of the hot, but the magistrate was a direct descendant of the consul defeated at Carthage. So it would have seemed likely that he referred to this event, however painful and negative. In our opinion, this hypothesis seems to us completely motivated and illogical, since the Battle of Caudium was defined by the later sources as an episode of the war against the Samnites and not as the conclusive event of armed conflict. We cannot understand the useful from the Roman magistrate to remember a Roman crushing defeat, which occurred when a member of his own gens was in command of the annihilated army. If we analyze carefully the coin typology with the iconographic method, we can reach the same Alfeldi's conclusions, albeit through a new line of reasoning. The left-wing character, older and bearded, covered with the simple weapons of the Italian warriors, holds a spear in the left hand, a symbol of the royal power, while the beardless warrior with armor and chlamys bears a spear with the tip down, a symbol of peace. The warrior can be recognized as Aeneas in the light of the many comparisons that depict the Trojan hero in Latium. He appeared in these garments in the two bronze medallions at the time of Antoninus Pius. In one, we see Aeneas and Iulus just landed from the ship, meeting on their way a cave with inside a large soul. In the other, we the same soul is about to be sacrificed in the presence of Aeneas and his son. In both medallions, Aeneas presents himself with an anatomical armor, teges and chlamys, as on the gold coin and on the silver denarius of Vetulium. You can see identical Aeneas dresses on the marble relief from Rome of the same age, now in the British Museum in London, with the similar scene of the first medallion of Antoninus Pius. Summing up our discourse, we seem to be able to affirm that the odd scene shown on the coin refers to the meeting and the subsequent alliance between Aeneas and Latinus. The memory of this ancestral pact is of fundamental importance from the Roman Res Publica at the crucial moment of the Carthaginian invasion of Hannibal. There was declared the aim was to divide Rome from its Italic allies. The concilium, not by chance in gold, because it intends to speak to the city's elite, wants to fix in the mind of the leader of all the Italic peoples that the Roman successes have been possible only thanks to agreement between the Trojans and the Latins, signed in the night of the times. The transfer of Palladium from Ilium to Rome is still reiterated by a bronze coin minted in Troy at the time of the Emperor Elagabalus. We can see the delivery of the statue of Minerva made by Aeneas in the center of the coin, which has the tiny Tikepoios of Ilium behind him and the personification of Rome in the front. Before coming to an end, we need to consider three bronze coins of Tyrus. One coin under Philippus I and the other two under Gallienus. On the reverse side of the three coins, we see a hero identified dubiously as Aeneas. In the first and in the second series, he is shown on a ship in the act of ordering its men to follow him. In the third, in which our hero is fighting against a dragon, we have the key of the mystery. The hero is Cadmus, who moves from Tyre to Thebes to establish his lineage there. In fact, Tyre has no relationship with Aeneas, except perhaps in the episode of Dido, which happened moreover in Carthage. Thank you.
We thank you. very much, Mr. Daniele. And we are inviting Mr. Kishbali Damas. It's from the Moscow State University.
I'm glad to be here today, and I would like to share with you some ideas concerning the janiform images on the silver coinage of the island of Tenedos, a place of foremost importance for the theme of today's conference, located on the topographical and mythographical axis connecting Troy to Tenedos. I'm not a numismatist, but I'm intrigued by the semantically rich iconography of Tenedian coins. My contribution is of an art historical character, as I'm interested in the various connotations and meanings the janiform imagery can bring. My presentation will consist of three parts. In the first part, is just a brief methodological introduction. In the second part, I'm going to speak about the various interpretations that exist about the male and female janiform on the coins of Tenedos. And in the third part, I want to examine other occurrences of double-faced imagery in ancient Greek art, including coins minted in other locations, but also, for example, vases. I include the periods mostly from the archaistic pre-Hellenistic, and the Roman era is outside the scope of my presentation now, so I won't be showing the janiform Dioscuri and other stuff like that. So, under janiform, we understand two conjoined heads facing in opposite directions, as the Roman Gardians. A janiform structure can serve many goals. For the purposes of this discussion, I highlighted three aspects. These aspects are not exclusive, and certainly more than one can apply in each case. However, I think that they are useful as a guideline. Often, janiform structures provide a unity of opposites. For example, juxtaposing characters, showing them along the same axis, parts of a single whole, but markedly different. This aspect can be described as a sort of a rhetorical approach. The second option is the emphasis on a complementary connection. The physical connection of the two hulls alludes to their connection in perhaps other ways as well. While this type also has a rhetoric aspect, we will see that this complementary connection is employed to show a mythical, historical, or perhaps a cultic religious link between the two hulls depicted of the whole. The third aspect of the use of janiform structures is to show liminality, demarcation of borders, boundaries, and bidirectionality. This is easy to show for statues set up in open spaces, for example, the depiction of Hermes set up on crossroads and borders. These Hermi were, judging by the evidence of face painting, mostly single-facing, but double-man Hermi may have already existed in the late archaic period, and of course become very popular in the Roman period. But such boundaries are less evident if the janiform is depicted in the enclosed visual frame of the coin. So overall, in this presentation, I will concentrate on the first two aspects. And now let us return to Tenedos. Tenedos started minting coins quite early, in the second half of the 6th century BC, as far as I understand, and kept producing its own types until the late Hellenistic period. There was only a gap in the late 4th, 3rd centuries BC. And it's interesting to see the proliferation of the same motifs over this long period of time. The most popular motifs were the male-female janiform on the ogres and the double axe, the labris or pelicus, on the reapers, surrounded by attributes like grapes, vessels, wreaths, sometimes other motifs as well. For example, the helmets of the Dioscuri. The interpretations that are met in scholarly literature of this iconography are based on the knowledge about the history and the cults of the island. I won't summarize the story of Tenedos and its founders, because it was already summarized by several people before me. I will just... everything is cut a bit. Okay. In any case, I wanted to show a simplified family tree of Themis, the son of Kyknos, of Colonai, who was the mythological founder of Tenedos. And I would just like to point out the sword that, according to Diodorus, Themis was a good and just king, and after his death, he became a locally worshipped hero with his own sacred precinct. So we know that references by ancient art authors are abundant, interesting, but also somewhat confusing and contradictory. What we learn is that the importance of the double axe as a symbol of Tenedos and an object that became proverbial, it's quite clear. it's used as votive objects in some contexts, a main sacrificial weapon, and it's a memento of past histories. Aristotle mentions the coins under discussion, in particular connecting the axe and the two heads with the story of the exile or perhaps execution of a son of a king, maybe Tanis. We also learn a lot about the various cults, especially the peculiar cults of Dionysus on the island of Tenedos, which I summarize here. But how can these pieces of information help with the understanding of the coin's iconography? And many scholars following in the footsteps of Aristotle seek to connect the double head on the and the labrys with the foundations of Tenedos. For example, identify the two heads as belonging to Tanis and his sister Hemithia, who was exiled with him. The double axes of Tenedos are also considered at length by Arthur Cook in his book about Zeus, who saw in them a survival of Bronze Age religion. However, I'm not sure I can tell you a lot about this peculiar object, but for the identification of the geniform head, he supports the version that it represents an amalgamation of Tanis and Hemithia. But as heroic representations of an earlier sky god and earth goddess, an interpretation that is similar to Cook's most ideas about myth and religion, but is ultimately unprovable. Other common path of inquiry is to try and connect the imagery with Orphism, in particular with the Orphic interpretation of Dionysus. In Orphic hymns, Dionysus is described as a being of two natures and two forms, which certainly sounds intriguing in connection with the geniform head. However, the Orphic hymns are somewhat later creation, and overall they have this tendency to show the god as an all-encompassing entity, and there are also many other figures who are called this. For example, in Orphic hymn 42, the goddess Misa is invoked alongside Dionysus. She's also of two natures, described as both male and female, but nobody tries to connect her with Tenedos. So overall, the Orphic element is not directly applicable to the coins of Tenedos. The scholarly consensus, maybe if there is such a thing, seems to follow the identification of the male and female geniform as the depiction of Hera and Zeus, which is interesting because if we combine Hera and Zeus and also the many attributes of Dionysus that appear on the reverse of the coin, we get something akin to the triad of gods worshipped at Lesbos and referenced in fragments of Sappho and Alcaeus. Perhaps this might have been an important regional religious concept, but we may never know. However, there's also a rare type of coins of Tenedos, which include a different reverse, not with Dionysic images and the labrys, but instead with the profile of a bearded man in a Corinthian helmet. Can it be maybe the image of Tanis, the eponymous hero of the island, whose cult and worship is mentioned by Diodorus? So, in any case, the Tenedic coins and the geniform heads on them could be a reference to a local cult or several local cults. But the interpretation is hard to pin down. If we continue and try to look for parallels and try to look for other geniform images, in numismatics, an interesting parallel can be found in Lampsacus, in the north of Troas or in Mysia, on the east side of the Hellespont. One of the ruins in the 5th-4th centuries BC features a geniform image on the obverse with two identical conjoined female profiles with a prominent shared earring for the two of them. The reverse depicts a helmeted head of Athena. The Lampsacene coinage displays a close connection to a rare type from Athens, which appears maybe slightly earlier or contemporary with Lampsacus. And some scholars explain the similarities between the Athenian and Lampsacene coinage with the historical ties forged between the two cities, the marriage of the daughter of Hippias to the son of Hippocles, the tyrant of Lampsacus, as mentioned by Thucydides in this quote. But what is the original meaning behind the original Athenian composition? For example, there's a noteworthy explanation proposed by Erica Simon, who explains the geniform coins of Athens as an identification of two figures as representations of Aphrodite Pandemos and Peitho. The two goddesses are connected, united, in a geniform iconography. According to Pausanias, their shared sanctuary was located in Athens, and its foundation story of the sanctuary was connected to the Synoikismos of Theseus. In this way, the ideological meaning of Bethel's help was clear. She facilitated the peaceful persuasion of the peoples. And this proposition seems highly likely and shows how complementary cults can be translated into a visual formula, the geniform emblem. Next, I would like to briefly examine the evidence provided by geniform vessels, a type that was very popular in the late archaic or the classical times. There are several wonderful examples from antique workshops, examples of such head vases. They exemplify both main aspects of geniform structures, the unity of opposites and sometimes the complementary connection. For example, strong contrasts were evoked in the combined depictions of various types, juxtaposed by gender, skin color, character, and we often see the contrast between satyrs and young women. And even sometimes, even the both halves are probably satyrs, they can be contrasted by age and pigmentation. The hero Heracles often appears, but unfortunately, his female partner, who he is paired with, is rarely identifiable. And also as an example of the aspect of not opposites, but of complementary connection, we can cite this wonderful combination of two identical female heads. And their joint is marked with a painted owl. I would argue that this vessel is very close, or maybe even identical in meaning to the Athenian coin type examined previously. And last but not least, I would like to examine a fragmented but beautiful vessel that is said to come from the Tara Mashuta court from Egypt. It's a silver cantharos, a double head vase with Lycian inscriptions, which I won't be talking about now. The relief above the faces in this part depicts the judgment of Paris. But what about the identification of the two heads? Strong offered as identification Paris and Helen, or Paris and Aphrodite, but also investigated the less likely but intriguing option of Cybele and Attis, which would make this silver cantharos one of the earliest depictions of the shared cult of Cybele and Attis in art. Others identified head as Aphrodite or Helen or and Paris. But alongside these pairings, in my opinion, it is worth considering that the two heads on the vase might belong to Artemis and or Amazons, judging by the Phrygian cap. And the shoulder strap of an early Hellenistic caress with the depiction of an Amazon can be cited as a parallel. But overall, this is a hypothesis that needs to be studied further. And I would like to say that geniform heads appear on several other types over the ancient world. However, I cannot touch upon them due to the limited time, but of course due to my own limited knowledge about them. However, in the future it would be interesting to examine these as well. Examples include the coinage of Syracuse in the age of Timoleon, with conjoined female heads, identical female heads as far as I understand, but also the mints of Malos in Cilicia. In this part of the screen, the coins of Thassos and Macedon, and also the intriguing coins of Philistia, which come from Gaza mostly, but probably also from Ashdod. These types are especially close to the Canadian coinage, and after hearing about after hearing some of the presentations about Melkart in connection to Tenedos, who knows, maybe I should have delved into this further. But let's just leave this for now. So, overall, in conclusion, we see that geniform structures their potential to show both contrast and connection, as I hope to have shown, are used to great effect in ancient Greek art, including numismatics. And on the coins of Tenedos, the composite head helped to elaborate the intricacies of local cults, and they have picked this iconography to show their these intricacies. Thank you for your attention.
Okay, thank you very much for keeping the time. So we switch to the next speaker. That's Miss Nadezhda Nalimova. And the title of her presentation is Cult of Apollo Smintheus, its reflection in the Iliad and the sculptural decoration of Apollo's temple near Gulpina.
Before I start, I wanted to thank the organizers of this important conference and to thank Dr. Dominique Borka for the opportunity to come and to participate as a speaker, and I hope to make at least a small contribution to the topic of the conference. Actually, my topic is not directly connected with Tenea and even to Tenedos, and it concerns the cult of Apollos Mintaeus, which is very important for the land of Troas. For the land of Troas, this cult, of course, is a complex problem, scientific problem. And during this very short presentation, it is important to touch upon all these aspects of this cult. So my aim is to examine it in the perspective of two interrelated sources, and I would say in the interconnection of these two sources, literal and visual, and mainly to trace how this cult and the image of Apollos Mintaeus himself find the representation in these sources. First one is, of course, the Iliad. Yeah, and some later testimony that follow this Homeric line, and to help to clarify some important details, will be also engaged. And the second one is a sculptural decoration of Apollos Mintaeus' temple, which you can see on the screen, discovered near the modern village of Gulpina in northwestern Troas. The date of this temple is a bit controversial, but the most accepted date is mid-second century BC. Let's start with Homer. In the opening verses of the Iliad, we find the earliest surviving mention of Apollos Mintaeus, of Apollo bearing the epithet Mintaeus. And it is the only reference to this epithet throughout the Iliad. The priest Croesus praises Apollo. He calls him Mintaeus, protector of Crete and Kyle, both places are in Troas. And he also designates him as the lord of Tenedos. So the special patronage of the god over these territories is clear. And later authors, including, for example, Ovid and Lilian, will support this close relationship of Apollos, Mintaeus, and his worshipping with the land of Troas, along with the archaeological evidences, and gives the reason to believe that Apollos Mintaeus was originally a local deity of Troas, worshipped in such centers as Crete, definitely in Hamaxitos, and also probably in the islands of Tenedos, and later, of course, in Alexandria Troas, when the city was founded at the end of the 4th century BC. In the Hellenistic time, we know that main festival of Alexandria Troas was named Smintia, and the cult spread to the island of Rhodes, where a festival with the same name was also held. Returning to the Homer, answering the prayer of Croesus, Apollo sends deadly arrows bearing plague to the Achaeans' camp. Later, when Odysseus brings back Croesus' daughter, the priest repeats his invocation and again calls Apollo protector of Crete and Kyle and lord of Tenedos. Now he asks the god to revert the plague from the Greeks, and Apollo shows his mercy to Achaeans. Homer offers no explanation or comments on this cult name, Mintaeus, and probably the meaning of it was not very clear in antiquity. Nevertheless, later writers are generally agreed that it derives from the word mythos. Also, they don't recognize this word as being Greek in origin, this word which indicates the field mouse. And this idea seems to have already existed in the 7th century BC. But Homer says nothing about mice, and this aspect of cult is not reflected in the sculptures of Mintaeus. Thus, the relation of Apollo to mice is another issue, and I will touch it just in part. Basically, we have two answers on this question provided by ancient writers. These writers are Strabon, who is following Calenus of Ephesus, and Polemon of Ilion, cited by the scholars of the Iliad. The second story is more important for us due to several reasons. Firstly, because it was cited to explain the event. Secondly, because Polemon, the author of the Pelagius and Ilions, could possess some local knowledge about the cult, at least at his time. And finally, because Polemon was active probably in the time of Mintaeus' construction, actually a bit earlier, but still close. In Polemon's story, we have another priest of Apollo, and again he resides in Crete, whose name is Crinis. Angered by him, Apollo sent an invasion of mice, which destroyed all crops. Vision to reconcile, the god appeared to Orbis, who was not to the priest, but to man named Orbis, who was the chief of the priest's shepherds. And being welcomed by him, Apollo promised to avert the evil, and immediately destroyed the mice with his arrows. The scheme of Apollo's behavior is very similar to what we find in the Iliad. Apollos Menteus acts as a terrible archer and as a powerful inflictor and averter of the disaster, which in the Polemon story is embodied in mice and in Homer's story in blood. When leaving, Apollo ordered Orbis to declare his miraculous appearance to Crinis. And in the place where the miracle happened, Crinis built a temple of the god, calling him Sminteus, because, as Polemon explains in the local dialect, mice are called Smintoi. In the Iliad, we also hear about the temple, by the way, because Crinis says in his first prayer that he roofed this temple several times. Let us now turn to the real temple built near Vilpena in the 2nd century BC. This remarkable building was erected on the place, or at least not far from the place, of Homeric priest's residence. Town of Crete is now supposed to be nearly 2 kilometers west to the Sminthean, near modern Göztepe. The Homeric sanctuary of Apollo is archaeologically unknown, but it could have existed somewhere near Crete. Later, in the middle of the Hellenistic period, it was probably moved to the area of Sminteum. Anywhere, no archaeological evidence predating the classical period has been found so far at the place of Sminteum. Hellenistic temple was constructed according to the pseudo-dictoral plan in Ionic order. Its decorations consist of two series of sculptures. The external figurative frieze, you can see it in the storage museum of the Vilpena. Two series of sculptures. The external figurative frieze in the entablature and the relief column drums, so-called columnae caelatae. Of the priest, just 19 slabs had survived. We don't know the exact number of slabs and how long this frieze might be. According to Professor Pushkunov Ganev, the leader of the excavation team, the whole storyline of the priest can be linked to the text of the Iliad and other epic poems, the Cypria, the Euperses, and the Little Iliad. But it is necessary to say that not all reliefs of the priest are in line with the Homeric text, as well as with known variants of iconography. In some cases, the state of preservation makes it difficult to judge. Nevertheless, even if the identification of certain scenes can be questioned, it is very likely that the Iliad and Cypriot poems indeed determine the storyline of the frieze, which is of course very exceptional for the architectural frieze. Moreover, we have at least one literal concordance of the frieze of Sminthean with a Homeric text, the scene of Achilles grieving over Patroclus. Here we see the gesture of laying hands on the dead body, which, according to my knowledge, is not found in the earlier or later depiction of this scene. This motif seems to be directly taken from the Homer's text, which you can see on the screen. The main theme of the priest is a military heroism, translated through the epic narration. But in this Greece, we don't find any allusions on the cult of Apollos Minteus, at least in the slabs that have survived. But this theme is directly represented in the decoration of Columnae Caelatae, the most extraordinary element of the temple. The adoption of this carved form is it due to a specific Ionian tradition, as we know, originating in the archaic period. It is important that here they were definitely placed, they were definitely placed on the top of the columns, under the capitals, forming decorative column necks. And this is the first temple where placement of the relief drums on the top can be clearly identified. Only 7 of such drums are known at the moment, and among them, 2 different types can be distinguished. The first one can be called narrative. According to Kozbiner, these narrative drums also represent scenes from the Iliad, initial episode including story of Croesus and Apollo's revenge to the Achaeans. Some parts of the frieze are heavily damaged, so it's difficult to discern the details. Nevertheless, we can clearly see the ships and the sitting figure with a bow, which should be shooting Apollo. As indicated in the text of the Iliad, Apollo sat down apart from the ships and led by an arrow. The other scenes were convincingly interpreted as following: Croesus coming to Achaeans, Odysseus returning Croesus to her father, and Thetis visiting Zeus. Interestingly, this group of subjects wasn't included in the narrative frieze, but put into the space of the colonnade on the columns. These figurative columns, with their enclosed circular movement, create a different atmosphere from the frieze, with its narrative and heroic overtone. By illustrating Iliad, they emphasize ritual aspects. We can see the images of animals, bulls and oxen, prepared for sacrifice, depicting on the depiction of the altars and processions. In Croesus episode in the Iliad, the theme of sacrifice is particularly emphasized and represented in great details as an act of reconciliation between the Achaeans and Apollo's priest and Apollo himself. In the Polemon story, a special role was assigned not only to the priest, but also to the Archibucor, chief shepherd, which also indirectly points to the theme of Hecaton, to the theme of sacrifice. This theme of sacrifice is expressed in a different way in the second group of the drums, which can be called ornamental. They are decorated with the sacrificial symbols carved in relief, bucephalia, garlands, and fiala. The decorative motif itself is not, of course, unique. It can be found in the early architectural decoration, starting with the Arsinoean and Propylon of Ptolemy II on Samothrace. And in patent version, we can find even earlier examples. Later in Pergamon, this motif appears in the frieze of the Propylon of Athena's sanctuary, where ornamental composition, very similar to our lip drums, can be seen. However, the combination of this type of decor with a round column shape is not found in the previous architecture examples. It seems to be absolutely innovative. And this feature provokes a special association, in my opinion, with round altars, which are widespread in the Hellenistic period. Their production seems to start at the late 3rd or beginning of the 2nd century BC. The most eloquent examples of such round parallel come from the Dodecanes Islands, from Rhodes and Kos, as we know. Among these round altars, there are those decorated with garlands and bull heads, which can be votive of funeral and function. Some of them offer the close parallels to the corresponding patterns in the Smithereens ornamental drums. It is possible that the Smithereen drums affected to the design of the round altars with similar decoration. But perhaps we can assume the inverse situation as well, that votive or funeral altars affected architecture. Probably a good precedent of such way of thinking can be found in the rock cut tomb, of Archocrates, who was a priest in the temple of Athena in Olympus. The most impressive element of this tomb is a monumental facade. 4 cylindrical altars with the garlands and the bullheads were elevated to the level of the second floor over the Doric portico, and they were not functional, but were used as an element of architectural composition and raised up in order to be highlighted and visible from a distance. Symbolically, they probably indicate the priesthood of the deities and associate the tomb with the temple or the sanctuary. It is worth noting that the tomb facade looks directly to the temple of Athena on the Acropolis of Olympus. Returning to Smithereen, okay, I have to finish, so I won't speak about the figurative drums, because they also have similarities with the decorated altars. In conclusion, I think that those who initiated the construction and decoration of the Cement Fair definitely aimed at showing their links with Troy, which of course offered political and cultural prestige. And I think that Pergamon Attalides could be such initiators or at least supporters of the construction of this new temple. But this is another topic, of course. And at the time, at the same time, they probably wanted to pay special homage to the local priesthood, which in a sense also inherits the tradition of the Homeric past. I think the introduction of this new altar-like drums gave the viewers some special allusions to the themes of damnation, votive offering, and sacrifice. And this feature emphasized the role of the priesthood in the pleasing of powerful God. Actually, this formula is clearly expressed in the words of Homeric Croesus, who says to Apollos Menteos, "If ever I roofed over the temple of your please, for your pleasing, if ever I burned to you the five pieces of the bulls and goats, fulfill this prayer for me." Thank you very much.
Спасибо вам, Надежда. Как ваше учреждение было? Ладно, Надежда Анатольевна, спасибо вам. Thank you very much for your contribution. We could pass to the next paper, next contribution, by Katsunopoulou Dora. Α, κύριε Κατσονοπούλου. Ναι, και εγώ λέω τι έγινε, δεν θέλω να σηκώνατε κανείς και άρχισε να ανησυχώ. Ναι. The cult statue of Apollos in Thebes, again an interesting paper on Apollo, in the Troad by Scopas of Paros.
Next up.
Παρακαλώ.
In the classical period, a good number of statues by famous Greek sculptors were set up in various cities of the Troad region, and especially, αν είναι πολύ κοντά, νομίζω θα ακούγεται πολύ έντονα. And especially in Parium, a colony of the island of Paros on the Propontis. The first of these works was a bronze statue of Heracles made for Parium by the sculptor Egesias of the early 5th century BC, as Pliny mentions. We do not hear about other famous works in the region for the rest of the 5th century, perhaps due to events associated with the history of the Athenian League after the seat of the League was transferred to Athens in 454 and heavier tax was imposed on the members of the League. However, in the 4th century BC, a flourishing is apparent in the culture of the Troad, with the dedication of masterpieces by celebrated Greek artists, which is most probably associated with the historical events of the 4th century, and particularly the period following the peace of Antalcidas in 387-86 BC. Two of these masterpieces were set up in Parion, one probably in Apollonia Adrindacum, and another in Chrysi. For the city of Parion, a marble statue of a nude Eros, represented on coins of Parion and recognized in the cost type of Eros, was made by the great Athenian sculptor Praxiteles, which was, according to Pliny, as celebrated as his famous Aphrodite of Pylos. The second renowned work of sculpture was a bronze statue of the Trojan prince Alexander Paris, probably to be recognized in the Borghese type of a youth wearing a Phrygian hat, by the Greek sculptor Euphranor from the Isthmus near Corinth, a contemporary of Praxiteles, an equally famous artist who produced excellent works both in statuary and in paintings. Another work by Praxiteles, a bronze statue of Apollos Auroctonos, was probably set up at Apollonia Adrindacum in Mysia and suggested by its appearance as a cult statue on local coins for a very long period. The fourth famous statue, which is the particular subject of this presentation, was the cult statue of Apollos Minthaeus in the Troad. According to the geographer's table, the cult image of Apollo for his temple in Chrysi, representing the god with the mouse, was made by Scopas of Paros a renowned sculptor of the 4th century BC, contemporary of the Athenian Praxiteles. Apollo's epithet Smintheus, as also Strabo specifies, owes its etymology to the mouse, an animal controlled and used by the god to cause plague and destruction, and relates with the anger and consequent punishment inflicted by the god against those committing impiety. As described in the first book of the Iliad, Apollo Smintheus sent the plague against the Achaeans to take revenge of the capture of Chryses. Or, according to local traditions, the god, angry with the people of Chryse for an unknown reason, sent the mice to ravage their crops. Later, the god himself killed the mice and freed the place from the plague, and in gratitude, his priest established in Chryse the cult of Apollo Smintheus, named after the local name of the mouse, Sminthos. The commissioning of a celebrated sculptor of the late classical times, like Scopas, to create the cult statue of Apollo for his temple in Chryse shows that in the 4th century BC, the temple was a well-known cult place and only a famous work of art would be considered appropriate to be housed here. Scopas was a famous cult image maker, Agalmatopios, praised together with Phidias and Praxiteles. Ancient sources refer to an impressive number of cult statues made by Scopas for temples and sanctuaries in various places of the ancient world. This included all these statues, 20 in number, that I show in this picture. And as you can see, it's all over almost the ancient world, from Elis, Maiden Greece, to Asia Minor, and even to further northwest in the Troy. The fame of the Parian sculptor as cult image maker was apparently the reason for the people of Chryse to commission Scopas on the creation of the cult statue of Apollo for his famous sanctuary in the Troy. If the archaistic type of the god preserved on a unique coin of around 300 BC from Alexandria Troas, showing Apollo with the mouse, represents the work of Scopas mentioned by Strabo, we must assume that the Scopaic image of the god for his temple in Chryse was most probably based on the iconography of an older statue in the temple. In this image, the god is shown to the right, clad in hymation with quiver at the shoulder, holding phiali in the outstretched right arm and bow in the left, ready to shoot as described in the Homeric scene. In front of Apollo and at his feet, the mouse is portrayed. In similar pose, bearing the same main attributes, quiver, phiali, and bow, in some cases with addition of other objects like tripod or flaming altar, but without the mouse, Apollo is frequently seen on Hellenistic and colonial coinage of Alexandria Troas. On these issues, we can observe a variety of representations. The statue shown within the temple, offerings made to the statue either by Alexander the Great or by Crinis the priest related to the foundation of the Apollo Smintheus sanctuary, the statue held in the hands of personifications like Tyche, wisdom, or genius, the statue saluted by Alexander the Great. The frequent appearance of the cult image of Apollo on the city's coinage suggests that the cult of Apollo Smintheus spread here following the cynicism and foundation of Antigonia by Antigonus the One-Eyed around 310 BC, later renamed as Alexandria Troas. Further, on Roman coinage from Alexandria Troas, there is another type of Apollo shown. The god is naked to the right foot resting on a pedestal, holding in the right hand branch, while the left rests on his hip and occasionally with a raven before him. Although this time shows stylistic traits compatible with the 4th century BC sculpture, I would rather not associate it with the Scopaic Apollo, as it does not match the characteristics Coppaid style and also misses the most important symbol of Apollo's Nymphaeus, the mouse, to which the god owes its own epithet and cult, showing on the contrary the raven. Also, this type appears on other Mysian coins of Cyzicus and Apollonia Archeodacum. The association of the archaistic type of the Hellenistic coinage from Alexandria Thrace with the Scopaic statue of the god is possible, as the type apparently refers to an older cult image of Apollo in his temple, as also suggested by the description of the working stable, where it is said that the mouse lies beneath the foot of the god Xoan, omis hypokite topodi tou Xoan. On the other hand, although the main and most famous aspect of Scopas art is the introduction of pathos in sculpture, clearly expressed via his dynamic and emotionally charged figures, there is also another very interesting aspect, usually obscured by the pathos element prevailing when one refers to the Scopaic style. This other aspect concerns the revival of archaic forms by creating images in an advanced time looking back at the past style. Apart from Apollo's Nymphaeus, a number of other works of Scopas could be assigned to this category. His marble Hecate for her temple in Argos, probably originating from Alcamene's type of Hecate Triformis, the two statues of the Erinyes of Parian Lignitis made for their sanctuary in Athens. We do not have any clues on their iconography, but if we judge from Pausanias' explanation that the Semne, as called in his description, did not look terrifying but modest, probably Scopas chose to approach their representation in an archaistic style, following the stiffness of archaic forms instead of shaping the images in his pathos style, which would be fitting to a representation more closer to the Erinyes with snakes in the hair and terrifying looks. Scopas Apollo on the Palatine also seems to fit with the aspect of archaism in this style, a comparison with the Villa Albani relief of Augustan age, where the god is represented accompanied by Leto and Artemis in front of an altar outside the temple, generally interpreted as the temple of the Palatine, is illuminating. In fact, this relief brings us back to an earlier archaistic representation of the subject, the frieze of the dancing women from Samothrace, despite some expressed views against the connection of the work with Scopas. The similarities in attitudes, position of hands, subtlety and elegance are evident, and Scopas' involvement in this work cannot be excluded. Regarding Apollo's statue, included by Pliny in the Scopaic Corpus and identified with an Apollo from Ramnus in Attica, transferred later in the Palladium in Rome, it has been recognized in numerous fragments from a destroyed marble colossal statue still to be reconstructed, found on the Palatine Hill during the excavations by Caretoni in the mid-1960s. Identification with the Scopaic cult statue of the Apollo Palatine is suggested by both its dimensions and the high quality of the work, especially seen on the intact parts of the fragment that we see here to the right, of the head preserving the left eye, cheek, forehead and hair, made in Parian marble of the excellent quality. With regard to this marble piece found in Rome, it is certainly of interest that another high quality marble fragment, possibly from the cult statue of Apollo's Nymphaeus, was found within the temenos of the Hellenistic temple excavated. The fragment belongs to the lower part of the leg of the statue, possibly made of Parian marble, as Antonio Corso, who has seen it, has informed me, and I thank him for the information. And if it comes from the 4th century statue, then a new find, probably from the hands of the master, is now to be added to the few original works survived of this great Parian sculptor and his workshop. Given that probably there was no temple standing at Smithion when Scopas created the cult statue of Apollo sometime in the decade 360-350 BC, it should be considered that the Scopaic cult image originally stood in the temple of Apollo's Nymphaeus at Chrysi, or possibly in Amaxitos nearby, as otherwise suggested, including numismatic evidence. Finally, A separate mention should be made of another distinctive feature of the Apollos Nymphaeus by Skopas, the creation of the combined group of a deity and an animal, symbolizing the epithet and the particular capacity of the god represented. Skopas seems to have been familiar with the subject, as he had made earlier another image of a deity and an animal combined in a group for the Greek mainland. It is the cult statue of Aphrodite Panthemos, Skopas' only work in bronze, made around 370-360 BC for her sanctuary in the town of Elis in the Peloponnese, showing the goddess riding on a goat through the troubled sea to express intense desire and excitement symbolized by the animal. Concluding, I would like to stress that what I presented above shows that the 4th century BC represents an era of intense cultural interaction between Greece proper and Asia Minor, and hopefully continuation of work in Smithion will provide new data on the history of the temple and the cult of Apollo Smintheus, as well as on the history and iconography of his cult statue. Thank you very much for your attention.
Now we shall pass to the next contribution by Mr. Nakasis Angelos on the Temple A at Palantium.
Καλησπέρα σας. Η ανασκαφή στην Ακρόπολη του Παλατίου ξεκίνησε η Ιταλική Αρχαιολογική Σχολή Αθηνών το 1940, οι οποίες δεν ολοκληρώθηκαν γιατί ξέσπασε ο πόλεμος. Τότε αποκαλύφθηκε τμήμα των τυχών και οι τέσσερις ναοί A, B, C και D. Την περίοδο 1984-1990, το Νορβηγικό Αρχαιολογικό Ινστιτούτο, σε συνεργασία με την Ιταλική Σχολή, συνέχισε τις έρευνες. Ακολούθησαν έρευνες της εφορίας αρχαιοτήτων Τρυπόλεως την περίοδο 2008-2009. Κατά τη διάνοιξη απλάκων για τη διοχέτευση υδάτων στη λίμνη Τάκα, αποκαλύφθηκε νέο τμήμα της οχύρωσης και σπίτια της πόλης. Την περίοδο 2011-2012 πραγματοποιήθηκαν εργασίες στην Ακρόπολη και αποκαλύφθηκε κι άλλο τμήμα των τυχών. Στα πλαίσια της διδακτορικής μου διατριβής, ερεύνησα ναούς με δευτερεύουσες προσπελάσεις. Από το 2015 και μετά, μελέτησα τον ναό Α, κατόπιν άδειας της εφορίας αρχαιοτήτων Τρυπόλεως. Το Παλάντιον σχετίζεται με τη Ρώμη αλλά και με την Τρία. Σε όλη την Ιταλία παρατηρείται η εξάπλωση αρκάδων απίκων. 60 χρόνια πριν τον Τουρκικό Πόλεμο, ο ήρωας Εύανδρος από το Παλάντιον με δύο καράβια πήγε ως έπικος εκεί που αργότερα δημιουργήθηκε η Ρώμη. Ο Οβίδιος γράφει πως όταν έφτασε ο Εύανδρος εκεί υπήρχαν μόνο χόρτα, λίγα πρόβατα, αραιά δέντρα και αραιότερες καλύβες. Την περιοχή έλεγχαν αρκάδες που επέτρεψαν στους συμπατριώτες τους να κατοικήσουν σε ένα λόφο. Την ακριβή θέση του οικισμού στην αριστερή όχθη του Τίβερη πέδειξε η μάτη μητέρα του Εύανδρου. Ο Εύανδρος έδωσε στον οικισμό το όνομα της γεννήτριάς του Παλάντιον προς τιμή του γενάρχη των Αρκάδων Πάλατος. Γι' αυτό ο Στράβων αναφέρει ότι η Ρώμη ελληνικών είναι κτίσμα και αρκαδική αποικία. Επειδή ο οικισμός αυτός ήταν η επαρχή για τη δημιουργία της Ρώμης, ο αυτοκράτορ Αντωνίνος ο Ευσεβής, αναγνωρίζοντας τον Παλάντιον ως Μητρόπολη της Ρώμης και τον Εύανδρο ως ιδρυτή της, αφού επισκέφθηκε το σχεδόν εγκαταλειμμένο τότε αρκαδικό Παλάντιο, το επίκησε, το ξαναέκτησε, μετατρέποντας το πάλι σε πόλη και απείλαξε τους κατοίκους από φόρους. Ο Εύανδρος ήταν γιος του μυθικού βασιλέως της Αρκαδίας Εχέμου ή του Θεού Ερμού και μιας νύμφης κόρης του ποταμίου Θεού Λάδωνος, η οποία αναφέρεται με διάφορα ονόματα Θέμης, Τέλφουσα, Θυμάνδρα, Νικοστράτη, Θέτης, Καρμέντα στα λατινικά. Ο Εύανδρος είχε κόρες τη Ρεώμη και τη Δίνη και γιο τον Πάλαντα, που πέθανε άδειπνος, αν και η Φαβία Γενιά έλεγε ότι κατάγεται από τον Εύανδρο. Κατά τον Διονύσιο τον Αλικαρνασέα, πολλοί συγγραφείς, όπως ο Πολύβιος, γράφουν ότι η κόρη του Ευάνδρου Λαβινία απέκτησε με τον Ρακλή ένα γιο τον Πάλαντα. Ο Βιγγίλιος στην Ενιάδα είχε πρωταγωνιστεί τον Εύανδρο, που εκπολίτησε τους ντόπιους με νόμους, γραφή, μουσική και αλφάβητο. Οι Ρωμαίοι πίστευαν ότι επινόησε και το λατινικό αλφάβητο. Εισήγαγε επίσης τη λατρεία του Λύκειου Απόλλωνος, της Δήμητρος, του Ποσειδώνος και του Πανός, που εξελίχθηκε στα Λουπερκάλια, μια δημοφιλή ποιμενική γιορτή. Ο Ηρακλής, αφού πραγματοποίησε το 10ο άθρο του φωνεύοντας το Γυριόνι, επισκέφθηκε τον Εύανδρο, ο οποίος ανήγειρε βωμό προς τιμή του. Στο βωμό αυτό θυσίασε ο Αινίας και τα πληρώματά του από την Τρία, όταν επισκέφθηκε τον γυραιό τότε Εύανδρο προκειμένου να ζητήσει βοήθεια. Πράγματι, στη μάχη του Αινία με τον βασιλιά Τούρνο, πήρε μέρος στρατός του τυχόντων Πάλατα. Ο Εύανδρος βοήθησε τον Αινία λόγω παραδοσιακών οικογενειακών δεσμών, διότι ο Αγχίσης, πατέρας του Αινία, είχε παλαιότερα συναντηθεί με τον Εύανδρο και διαπίστωσαν ότι είχαν κοινή καταγωγή από τον Άντρατα. Προς τιμήν του Ευάνδρου, ονομάστηκε Παλατίνος, ένας από τους 7 λόφους της Ρώμης, που κατάληξε να λέγεται Παλατίνος. Στους πρόποδες του Αβεντίνου λόφου υπήρχε βωμός προς τιμήν του. Ο Στράβων και ο Πλούταρχος γράφουν ότι οι Ρωμαίοι τιμούσαν με εορτές και τη μητέρα του Ευάνδρου, Καρμέντα. Βωμός της υπήρχε στους πρόποδες του Καπιτολίνου λόφου, κοντά στην πόρτα Καρμένταλης. Ο Παυσανιάς αναφέρει το χώμα Αγίης, ένα φράγμα πυναϊκών θρόνων στη λίμνη Τάκα, που μαζί με αποστραγγιστικά έργα εμπόδιζε τα νερά να κατακλείσουν το παλαιτικό πεδίο. Στην περιοχή του Παλατίου, ο Παυσανίας περιγράφει δάσους με μελανιδιές και μέσα στην πόλη, ναό και λίθινα αγάλματα του Πάλατος, του Ευάνδρου, της Δήμητρος και της Κόρης. Το Παλάτιο κατήχε σημαντική θέση μεταξύ των αρκαδικών πόλεων, όπως υποδηλώνεται και από την ονομασία Πύλη του Παλατίου, του τείχου της Μαντινίας. Η ακτινοβολία του Παλατίου εκτός Αρκαδίας μαρτυρείται και από επιγραφή τέλους του 4ου αιώνα π.Χ. που αναφέρεται σε προαιώνια σχέση μεταξύ Παλατίου και Άργους. Η ταύτιση της θέσης του Παλατίου είναι από τις λίγες στην Αρκαδία που έχουν αποδειχθεί όχι μόνο τοπογραφικά, αλλά και βάσει της προαναφερθής της επιγραφής. Τον 5ο και τον 4ο αιώνα το Παλάτιο εκτελεί νόμισμα. Το 369 λαμβάνει μέρος στο συνοικισμό της Μεγαλόπολης, σώζονται τμήματα της αμαξητής οδού από το Παλάτιο προς τη Μεγάλη Πόλη. Οι ναοί της Ακρόπολης του Παλατίου ήταν χτισμένοι από ομές πλίνθους σε λίθινη θεμελίωση. Προημότερος είναι ο Α, που χρονολογείται περί το 600 π.Χ. Ο Παυσανίας δεν αναφέρει σε ποιους θεούς ήταν αφιερωμένοι οι ναοί. Γράφει πως το ιερό είναι αφιερωμένο στους καθαρούς θεούς, τα ονόματα των οποίων οι κάτοικοι δεν ξέρουν ή δεν ξέρουν να αποκαλύψουν. Τους ονόμασαν καθαρούς, αφού σε αυτούς ο Πάλας πρόσφερε καθαρή θυσία προς τιμή του Λυκαίου Θεός και όχι ανθρωποθυσία όπως ο πατέρας του. Ο ναός Α, σχεδόν ορθογώνιος, έχει διαστάσεις περίπου 6x9.30 με εσωτερικό βωμό. Είχε θύρα στο άκρο της στενής ανατολικής πλευράς, που συμβατικός θεωρείται ως κύρια, επειδή βλέπει ανατολικά, αντί της φαρδύτερης θύρας που βρίσκεται στο μέσο περίπου της μακράς νότιας πλευράς. Ο ναός Α σχετίζεται με τη Μαντία και τη Φθόνια Λατρεία, όπως και άλλοι ναοί που είχαν ή πιθανότητα είχαν δευτερεύουσες προσπελάσεις και τους απόλυτους λόγους. Πρώτον, έχει εσωτερικό βωμό, όπως ο ναός Σε στο βωμό. Δεύτερον, είναι χτισμένο σε πλαγιά, ώστε οι πιστοί να παρακολουθούν ευκολότερα τα δρόμενα όπως είναι οι ναοί. Αρτέμιδος Ιαπόλεως, Απόλλωνος Ιαπόλεως, Απόλλωνος Θερίου, Απόλλωνος Καρθέας, Απόλλωνος Αμφανών, Απόλλωνος Θήρας, Κρόνων Κεφαλινίας, Αθηνάς Αληθίδας και Πατρόβου Απόλλωνος Αθηνών. Οι τελετουργικές διαδικασίες σχετίζονται με κατάλληλους χώρους πλησίων των ναών, όπως σε άλλες περιπτώσεις θέατρα, θεατρόσκηνοι χώροι, κερκίδες ή εξάρματα του εδάφους. Τρίτον, στην περιοχή λάμβανε χώρα λατρεία θνητών, των ηρώων Παλάτος και Ευάνου. Αντιστοίχως, λατρεύονταν στην Αλήφυρα ο Ομιλίαθρος, στο Ερέχθειον Ιβούτη και Κέκροξ, στην Αυλίδα η Ιφηγένεια, στον Οροπό ο Αμφιάραος, στην Τριζίνα ο Υπόλυτος, στην Κίζικο ο Αδριανός. Τέταρτον, η μητέρα του Ευάνδρου ήταν Μάντης. Πέμπτον, ο ναός έχει δευτερεύουσα θύρα. Οι ναοί που έχουν δευτερεύουσες θύρες συνήθως συνδέονται με χθόνιες λατρείες ή τη Μαντία που έχει επίσης χθόνια χαρακτηριστικά. Αρκετοί ναοί φέρουν δευτερεύουσες θύρες. Οι ναοί που διαθέτουν δευτερεύουσα προσπέλαση αποτελούν ένα ποσοστό. Παρόμοιο ποσοστό πρέπει να δεχτούμε για τις περιπτώσεις που οι ναοί αποκαθίστανται με μία μόνο προσπέλαση χωρίς αυτές αποδείξεις. Χαρακτηριστικό παράδειγμα αποτελεί ο ναός του Απόλλωνος Δελφών, ο οποίος είχε αποκατασταθεί κατά το εντός εισαγωγικών πρότυπο μόνο με μία θύρα κατά τον άξονα του, ενώ διέθετε δύο πλευρικές θύρες. Η πρώτη ανασκαφική έρευνα του ναού του Απόλλωνος Καρθέας δεν αναφέρει πλευρική θύρα, η οποία επισημάνθηκε από τους τελευταίους μελετητές. Ο ναός της Αρτέμιδος Λουσών αρχικά είχε νομιστεί ότι είχε δύο πλευρικές θύρες, ενώ είχε μόνο μία. Στη βιβλιογραφία δεν υπάρχουν αρκετά στοιχεία για τη σημασία της θέσης των δευτερεύουσών θυρών. Υπάρχουν αναφορές χωρίς περαιτέρω εξήγηση του φαινομένου. Ενδείξεις για ύπαρξη πλευρικών θυρών έχουν αρκετοί ναοί. Οι δευτερεύουσες πλευρικές θύρες απαντούνται από το μέσο μέχρι το βάθος του σικού. Πλευρική θύρα είχε λαθεμένα θεωρηθεί ότι είχε στο εμπρόσθετο τμήμα του σικού ο ναός Ασκληπίου Μεσίνης. Στην περιοχή όμως που προτάθηκε θύρα δεν υπάρχουν κόμφοι ή ίχνη διαφορικής διάδοσης από υπερκατασκευές του κατοχιού ή πατήματα. Αρκετοί μονοχώροι ναοί, όπως ο ναός Άρχων του Παλαντίου, διαθέτουν δευτερεύουσες προσπελάσεις. Παρατίθεται ορισμένα γραφήματα σχετικά με τις θεότητες που λατρεύονται στους εξεταζόμενους ναούς. Οι περισσότεροι ναοί είναι προσανατολισμένοι ανατολικά. Οι περισσότεροι είναι νεότεροι. Βλέπουμε εδώ τη γεωγραφική κατανομή των εξεταζόμενων ναών. Σχεδόν όλοι οι ναοί έχουν άμεση ή έμεση σχέση με τη μαντεία και τη χρησιμοδοσία, ενώ όλοι έχουν σχέση με χθόνιες λατρείες. Από όσα προαναφέρθηκαν, φαίνεται πως ο ναός Άρχων του Παλαντίου σχετίζεται με χθόνια λατρεία. Σας ευχαριστώ για την προσοχή σας.
Ευχαριστούμε τον Άγγελο Ανακάση για την ενδιαφέρουσα παρουσίαση για το Παλάντιο και σε σύγκριση με άλλους ναούς και με τις δευτερεύουσες θύρες. Ήταν κάτι διαφορετικό στη σημερινή ημερίδα. Και συνεχίζουμε με τον αγαπητό Σταμάτη Φαντζίλα. Ο κύριος Φαντζίλας είναι ο προϊστάμενος της εφορίας αρχιτέκτονας του Μεσσηνίας, του τμήματος. Ο κύριος Σταμάτης Φαντζίλας, λοιπόν, στο Βιβάλι.
In the middle of the Peloponnese, and not far from ancient Aenea, lies the Arcadian Palladium, which is mythologically and historically linked to Rome and Troy. Palladium was one of the most ancient towns of Arcadia. The mythical founder was Pallas, a son of Lycaon. It was situated west of Tegea in a small plain called the Palladic Plain. The ancient city is located some 7 kilometers southeast of Tripolis, just east of the old Tripolis-Megalopolis road. Palladium was centered on a low hill of moderate height. The hill of Agios Ioannis is visible when one crosses the new motorway before entering the tunnel of Kalligeriko, moving towards Tripoli-Kalamata. Palladium was a main Aegean city and took part in the foundation of Megalopolis. The archaeological site was discovered and excavated first by the Italian Archaeological School at Athens. On the top of the Acropolis and on its southern slope, there are 4 temple buildings. On the hill rising in front of Mount Gravary is the Chapel of St. John, Agios Ioannis. The church is set down on the foundation of a rectangular building, Temple Dip. Only the foundation are fragmentarily preserved since the whole church was built at this site. A few in the north with the same orientation there is a smaller Elia Megaron, Temple B. It's a small rectangular temple. On the south slope of the hill, on a large terrace, there are to be found the foundation of a temple apparently of the 5th century date. At the southeast slope, there is a small single temple with internal altar, which is the oldest one. All the archaic buildings seem to belong to a single program of construction dating to 600 BC. The two temples at the top of the hill and the other two at the southeast slope belong probably to the sanctuary dedicated to the bull gods mentioned by Pausanias. The Acropolis of Palladium was fortified. The town was visited by Pausanias, who found here a shrine containing statues of Pallas and Evand, and temple of Gore Persephone, a statue of Polybius. And on the hill above the town, which was anciently used as an Acropolis, a temple of the pure gods. The myth of the city origin was significant in ancient Roman mythology because Palladium became one of the cities that was merged later into ancient Rome. The Romans believed that Evander set out from there to set the Palatine in Rome. Dionysius of Halicarnassos writes that the Romans say that the Palladium or Palladium near the Tiber River on the future site of Rome was founded by Greeks from Palladium of Arcadia about 60 years before the Trojan War, and the leader was Evander. Evandros named Palladium after his birthplace according to Strabo. He says, Rome was an Arcadian colony planted by Evander. He entertained Hercules when driving the oxen of Chiron. The Roman historian Silius is of opinion that this is a proof that Rome is a Grecian colony, the sacrifice to Hercules after the Grecian mode having been brought over from the fatherland. They say the most intelligent Arcadian and the best soldier was Evander. He was sent to found a colony with an Arcadian expeditionary force from Pallandia. The mighty Roman Empire later developed around this, though the region is which Evander named Pallandion after his birthplace. Pallandion, with the loss of one L at one end, was called Pallandion according to Pausanias. A drawing of Claude Lorrain with the title The Arrival of Aeneas at Pallandion translated this Arcadian imagery in the 17th century into a landscape painting, a vessel landing at a small harbor. The crowd on the land is awaiting the arrival. The subject is taken from Virgil. After the epic voyage around the Mediterranean, Aeneas and his companions sailed up the Tiber, but soon found themselves at war with the tribes of Latium. Here Aeneas stands in the prow of his boat, holding out a peace offering of an olive branch to Pallas, son of Evander, king of Pallandium. In the distance is the city of Pallandium, site of the future Rome. Evander was honored as a demigod and benefactor by the Romans. Virgil states in the Aeneid that when Aeneas himself of Arcadian descent, like the Trojans, who were descendants of Dardanos, came to Rome, he encountered Evander and his son Pallas. The twins Romulus and Remus were also of Arcadian origin, as descendants of Dardanos and Aeneas, and undertook their mission to found a new city on the Palatine and Saturnine hills in Italy in the first year of the Seven Olympiad. The Palatine is the central hill of the Seven Hills of Rome. It is one of the most ancient parts of the city and has been called the first nucleus of the Roman Empire. It stands 40 meters above the Roman Forum and upon the Circus Maximus on the other. Much of the Palatine has not been excavated, except for the area nearest the Tiber, the residence of August, the temple of Apollo, and temples of Victory and the Great Mother are there. According to Livy, the Palatine Hill got its name from the Arcadian settlement of Pallandium. Evander brought the Greek Parthenon, laws, and alphabet to Italy when he founded the new city of the Palatine Hill. He plays a major role in the Virgil Aeneid books. Because of the traditional tides, Evander aids Aeneas in his war against Turnus and the Rutuli. The Arcadian had known the father of Aeneas and Anchises before the Trojan War and shares a common ancestry through Atlas with Aeneas' family. The tradition that Rome was an Arcadian colony was widespread in ancient times, particularly amongst Latin historians and poets. Another proof of the Roman belief that they were descended from the Arcadians is proved by the fact that in the 2nd century AD, the Roman Emperor Antoninus Pius visited Pallandion in Arcadia, declared the little township to be a city, and granted its inhabitant exemption from all taxation. Excavation in recent years in the lower town confirmed what is said by Pausanias, that the city was benefited in the 2nd century BC. During the visit of Roman Emperor Antoninus of Eusebius, the archaeological evidence of the period is in line with historical evidence. Excavation during 2008 were incorporated in the Lake Taka Reservoir construction project, while those of 2010 took place during construction work for the new Corinth Tripolis Kalamata motorway. Work was done on the Acropolis of Pallandium to clear and enhance the sanctuary of the pure gods, which today incorporates the foundation of four ancient temples. The city proper was situated in the plain at the northern and eastern foot of the hill. The lower town has been excavated. Remains of classical buildings have been found reused. Parts of the fortification wall were uncovered on the Acropolis on the low-lying areas of the ancient urban center. A series of test trenches opened in connection with the management of Lake Taka, which extend for circa 500 along the north-south axis of the ancient city on the lower plain. Archaic to Byzantine occupation was confirmed, with most pottery dated to the Hellenistic and Roman periods. At the distance of east of the Acropolis, one of the city's paved central roads was discovered, along with the two wings of a monumental peristyle building constructed after 318 BC when Palladio was captured by Polyperchon Macedonian troops. A major part of the city wall was found, only the foundation are preserved. The superstructure was mud brick. The central road ran east-west parallel to the city wall. At the north end lay the remains of a tower destroyed at the end of the 4th century BC and rebuilt slightly to the south. This likely followed the campaign of Polyperchon in the Peloponnese, when Megalopolis was besieged and Palladio also fell. Besides, it was a Hellenistic public store with north and east wings forming an angle of the agora. The main entrance to the store lies in the north part of the east side, with some secondary entrances to the north wing directly from the road. Marble spolia from the building were reused in a paved surface in front of the colonnade. Remains of the roof included stamped tiles, some marked damosios with a similar stamp to that used in the rear roofing of Temple C on the Acropolis and an Acroterium. The roof tiles inscribed with the word damosios confirmed the public character of the stoas and other buildings. The Hellenistic stoa complex was designed anew above its predecessor and not reused the earlier foundation. The early foundation of the public building in the Agora are also visible in recent excavation, as well as the layer of destruction associated with the siege of Palladium by the Macedonian forces. A 5th to 4th century archaic classical level was located at several points beneath the Hellenistic buildings. Pottery from the latest Stoa complex dates from the late classical to late Roman periods. Substantial stretches of the ancient road that led south towards a certain megalopolis have been located in the surrounding countryside of ancient Palladium. At the sites of Calogerico and Dema, the ancient road was discovered at a total length of 1 kilometer. The road was defined by roadside retaining walls. Various hydraulic works, such as canalization wall, built to manage the course of local streams in order to ensure the overland communication between the urban center and its surrounding countryside. Furthermore, a classical cemetery has also been identified. Roadside pit graves and Peter's burials located close by and above it was long stretch of bedding track for the transport of stone from extraction sites using wooden pallets, helonges. Modern excavation has revealed that Palladio did not decline in Roman times, as was the case with other Arcadian cities. Λόγω έλλειψης μετάφρασης, θα συνοψίσω τα συμπεράσματά μου στα ελληνικά. Οι ανασκαφικές έρευνες των τελευταίων ετών στην κάτω πόλη επιβεβαιώνουν τα λεγόμενα του Παυσανία, ότι η πόλη ευεργετήθηκε το 2ο αιώνα μετά Χριστό κατά την επίσκεψη του Ρωμαίου Αυτοκράτορα Αντωνίνου Τευσελού. Οι αρχαιολογικές μαρτυρίες της περίοδου συνάδουν με τις ιστορικές μαρτυρίες. Ο Αυτοκράτορας Αντωνίνος τον ακήρυξε, αποκόμισε πόλη ελεύθερη και του χάρασε απαλλαγή από κάθε φόρο, καθώς οι Ρωμαίοι αναγνώρισαν το Αρκαδικό Παλάντιο ως Μητρόπολη της Ρώμης. Οι Ρωμαίοι απέδιδαν πράγματι ιδιαίτερη λατρεία στον Εύαντρο από το Παλάντιο της Αρκαδίας, καθώς έγινε ο ιδρυτής του ομώνυμου πολίσματος στην Ιταλία πριν από την ίδρυση της Ρώμης από τον Ρωμίλο. Χρονικά, η άφιξη του Ευάνδρου στην αριστερή όχθη του Τίβερη, ποταμού στο Λάτιο, τοποθετείται 60 χρόνια πριν από τον Τροϊκό Πόλεμο. Τότε ο Εύανδρος, ως αρχηγός της αποικίας του Παλαντίου, λέγεται ότι καταστάθηκε μαζί με τους άλλους Αρκάδες και έδωσε το όνομα του Παλαντίου σε έναν από τους λόφους της Ρώμης, σε μικρή απόσταση από τον Τίβερη. Εκεί έφτιαξαν μια μικρή κόμη, αρκετή για την εγκατάσταση του πληρώματος δύο καραβιών, με τα οποία ήρθαν από την Ελλάδα. Αργότερα το όνομα Παλάντιο, που πήρε η κόμη αυτή από τη Μητρόπολη στην Αρκαδία, άλλαξε με την παράληψη των γραμμάτων Λάμδα και Νί. Τότε η πόλη μετανομάστηκε σε Παλατίνο Λόφο ή Παλάτιον, διότι ο χρόνος έφτιαξε το σωστό τύπο. Ο Στράφων αναφέρει επίσης πως οι Ρώμοι υπήρξαν κατοικοί από τον Εύαδρο και οι Ρωμοί τιμούσαν τη μητέρα του Ευάντου Νικοστράτη. Σύμφωνα με τον Διόδωρο, ο Ηρακλής κατά το 10ο άθλο, με τα βόδια του Ιγυριώνη, φιλοξενείται από τους κάτοικους του Παλατίου της Ρώμης δίπλα στις όχθες του Τίβερη ποταμού. Σύμφωνα με τον Διονύση Αλικαρνασέα, οι αρκάδες οδηγούμενοι από τον Εύαντρο εγκαταστάθηκαν στο Λάτιο, όπου ίδρυσαν διάφορες λατρείες συμπεριλαμβανομένων των Λυκείων που έμοιαζαν με τα Λουκαρκάλια, εορτές για την Νίκη, μια λατρεία για τη Δήμητρα και την Ιπποκράτη του Ποσειδώνα Επίου, γνωστά στη Ρώμη ως Κονσουάλια. Μια ολόκληρη επιστημονική παράδοση υπάρχει για τη μεταφορά λατριών από το αρκαδικό στο Ρωμαϊκό Παλάτιο. Ο Λύκειος Πάνας, η Νίκη, κόρη του Πάναντα, η Δήμητρα και ο ίδιος Ποσειδώνας συγκαταλέγονται στους θεούς για τους οποίους οι αρκάδες έκτισαν ιερά στην Αποικία και καθιέρωσαν θυσίες ανάλογα με τις αρκαδικές Μητρόπολης. Οι λατρείες αυτές υπάρχουν στη Ρώμη μέχρι τα Ρωμαϊκά χρόνια, όπως αναφέρει ο Διονύσιος Αλικαρνασσεύς. Συμπερασματικά, οι μετέωρες αρχαιολογικές έρευνες δείχνουν πως το παλάτι της Μεναλίας κατά τα Ρωμαϊκά χρόνια δεν υφίσταται παρακμή και κατάληψη όπως άλλες αρκαδικές πόλεις. Είχε σαφή ανάκαμψη και σχετική ευημερία, όπως δείχνουν ανασκαφές, από τη στιγμή που το Αρκαδικό Παλάτιο ήταν η Μητρόπολη της Ρώμης και υπήρχαν στενοί δεσμοί ανάμεσα στον Εύαρδρο και το γιο του Πάλατα με τον Ενία και τον Αχύση, που κατέφθηκαν πρώτα στην Αρκαδία και μετά στην Ιταλία. Τέλος, ευχαριστώ τη Διευθύντρια των Ασκαφών της Αρχαίας Αθηναίας για την πρόσκληση να συμμετάσχω σε επιστημονικό αυτό συνέδριο. Σας ευχαριστώ πολύ.
Ευχαριστούμε πολύ. Είστε πολύ ακριβείς. 15 ακριβώς λεπτά. Είστε φοβερός. Ευχαριστούμε. Και εδώ έληξε η συνεδρία, η τελευταία της σημερίδος μας. Πριν δώσω το βήμα για τα συμπεράσματα, θα θέλαμε να ρωτήσουμε σύντομα κάποιες ερωτήσεις από τους προλέκτες της ομιλητίας.
Ερωτήσεις.
Ερωτήσεις, όχι παρακαλώ, όχι κόμμα τις ερωτήσεις. Ναι, δυνατόν.
Υπάρχει στην περιοχή πριν το Παλάτιο μια οδός που λέγεται οδός Αντωνίνου και λέγεται ότι ο Αντωνίνος είχε εκεί κάποια έπαυλη την οποία διατηρούσαν πως ερωτησόμενος το άσπρο της Μωρίας. Αυτό το ψάχνω στη Ρωμαϊκή Αρχαιολογία του Γερανό.
Επόμενος.
Η ομιλία ήταν εξαιρετική, τα συγχαρητήρια μου. Το ερώτημα όπως τίθεται προέρχεται από τη δήλωσή σας ότι ο Εύαδρος 60 χρόνια πριν από το 1918 που έπεσε η Τρία, τι είδους γράμματα πήγε σε αυτούς τους ανθρώπους. Αυτό είναι το ερώτημα, γιατί υποτίθεται ότι είμαστε στην εποχή της γραμμικής βήτα τότε. Αλλά αν πήγε κάποια άλλα γράμματα και όχι τη γραμμική βήτα, τότε τίθεται ένα πολύ σοβαρό θέμα, πολύ ενδιαφέρον.
Προφανώς πήγε την αρκαδοκυπριακή διάλεκτο, αυτή που μιλούσαν στην εποχή αυτή, στην Αρκαδία. Και μετέφερε όλες τις θυσίες και, και όλους τους θεούς που είχε από τη Μητρόπολη. Όσον αφορά τώρα για την χρονολόγηση, το έχουμε συζητήσει και σε ένα άλλο συνέδριο πριν το Φλεβάρι, το δεν ξέρω αν θυμάστε για την χρονολόγηση της πτώσης της Τρίας. Αυτά σημαίνει τις ζωνές.
Επίσης, να πω κι εγώ ότι οι Ρωμαίοι θεωρούσαν ότι ο Εύανδρος τους έφερε και το λατινικό αλφάβητο. Δηλαδή, η παράδοση δεν έχει σημασία τι θεωρούσαν ακριβώς και τι ακριβώς είναι αλήθεια. Προφανώς έχετε δίκιο με την ερώτησή σας. Δεν μπορεί να τους πήγε κάποιο αλφάβητο.
Πήγε ότι τη διάλεξε την αρκαδική, την αρκαδοκυπριακή, αυτή ουσιαστικά που κρύβεται πίσω τη κοινωνική γραμμική βήτα τη Πύλου.
Με συγχωρείτε, είναι λάθος αυτό. Κατά τον Ουάρον αυτή είναι την αιωλική διάλεκτο.
Οι αρκάδες τι μίλουσαν αιωλικά.
Σας λέω τι λέγανε οι Ρωμαίοι. Είναι κατασκεύασμα. Δεν το καταλαβαίνετε.
Εντάξει,
προφανώς
είναι.
Είναι
ρωμαϊκό κατασκεύασμα. Σωστά, αλλά η γλώσσα των Αρκάδων ήταν παρεμφερής με εκείνο τη Μεσημείας και των υπόλοιπων ανατολικών κέντρων της εποχής αυτής. Τα ήταν, υποθέτουμε. Χωρίς να έχουμε δει, δεν έχουμε δει μετακλαμικής β' από την Αρκαδία. Έχουμε βέβαια μόνο τα κλασικά χρόνια.
Θα το συζητήσουμε έξω.
Τι θέλω να πω είναι ότι γενικά μέσω του Ευάνγελου και της Μητρόπολης που έγινε για τη Ρώμη, διαδόθηκε αρκαδισμός σε όλη την Ευρώπη, που έχει αφρία επίχυση όλο αυτό το φιλοσοφικό και ρεύμα στην εποχή της αναγέννησης και μετά.
Επόμενη ερώτηση.
I wish to ask to Professor Tamás, you know that the Pliny 36, Dr. 28, attributes either to Scopas or to Praxiteles, Janus, Janus head, probably with two faces, which he says was coming, came to Rome from Alexandria. Since representations of heads of a booster with two faces on the two sides are very rare and they are particularly rooted on Tenedos, do you think that it is possible that this double head was collectioned by the royalty of Alexandria from Tenedos when Tenedos was under Alexandrian rule? This is the question.
Ναι, θέλω να απαντήσω στην κυρία Αγγλή Μακάση. Α, συγγνώμη.
Yes, given... Very loud. Yes, given the strong connection between Alexandria and Troas and
Gianni.
In the period...
Gianni.
Yes, I think that's Gianni. Completely possible, but... yeah.
Thanks.
Okay, κάποιος άλλος, κάποια άλλη ερώτηση. Ο κύριος εκεί, ο Ιταλός. Ιταλιώτης. Ιταλιώτης, σωστός.
Έλληνα της Καλλιάς.
Καλός.
Just a note. There are three Palantion in the entity. One is Palantion of Palatinus, the other the most important Palantion in Arcadia. The third Palantion is the temple of Artemis Fagilitis in Rhegium. The third Palantion is the closer of the circle, because at Rhegium the cult of Artemis Fagelitis was taken from the Cancellus of Staricus by Iphigenia and Orestes. And the river near the Palantion, we discover under the sea the temple, the ancient temple of Palantion. And the river near the city in the ancient time was named Apsia, like the feast of Apsia in Sparta to Artemis. So there are three Palantion in the ancient time. Thank you.
Καλές αυτές οι διευκρινιστικές απαντήσεις. Κάποιος άλλος. Κυρία Τζάβες.
Ναι, θα ήθελα να πω ότι θα ήταν στη σημερινή μας συνάντηση και ο κύριος Χάρης Κουντελάκης, αρχαιολόγος και ιστορικός. Δυστυχώς δεν μπόρεσε να έρθει, όμως η ομιλία του θα μπει στα πρακτικά εννοείται, όπως έχει πει η κυρία Κόρκα, ο τίτλος της θα είναι «Τενέα, Τρόι, Λίμνος, Τένεδος, Εντίνος», βάζει και το νησί των Κυκλάδων. Εστιάζει μια καινούργια παράμετρο, γιατί ακούσαμε πολλά για την ονομασία της Τενέας, εκείνος θεωρεί ότι το όνομα προέρχεται από μια ονομασία, τα ΝΑΗ από τη γραμμική Α, η οποία αναφέρεται σε ένα ποτάμι, το οποίο το είδε από αεροφωτογραφία και κάνει το συσχετισμό μεταξύ των ποταμών και των και την ονομασία των ποταμών και των και ορισμένων επαρχιών, όπως λέει, ας πούμε, ότι υπάρχει, ότι είναι ο ποταμός Λούκα στη Λυκία, το Γέρον στην, ο Γέρον ποταμός στη Γέλα, ο Σίκελος στη Σικελία κτλ. Παρουσιάζει ένα ενδιαφέρον μια άλλη παράμετρος. Αυτό. Σας ευχαριστώ. Και επίσης πριν τελειώσω να συγχαρώ, γιατί δεν το έκανα ακόμα, την, πέρα από την κυρία Κόρκα, την έχω συγχαρεί από το πρωί και την έχω ευχαριστήσει, αλλά θα ήθελα και τους φίλους. Γιατί εγώ σαν πρόεδρος της Ελληνικής Ομοσπονδίας Φίλων Μουσείων, το τι καμαρώνω με όλη αυτή την στάση που είχαν οι φίλοι τόσα χρόνια και γενικώς και για σήμερα, αλλά υποθέτω ότι είναι δίπλα στην κυρία Κόρκα και, και στο Χιλιομόδη συνεχώς. Αυτό ήθελα να πω ότι συγχαίρω και χαίρομαι πάρα πολύ και καμαρώνω.
Έλληνα, ελπίζω να μην μου θυμώσεις αν πω δύο λόγια παραπάνω. Στην προηγούμενη συνεδρία δεν πρόλαβα να πω τίποτα, είχα μερικές ερωτήσεις. Αλλά επειδή βλέπω εδώ και εξαιρετικούς συναδέλφους που τους γνωρίζω από τον κύριο Μαυρογιάννη από την Κύπρο, κύριε Μαυρογιάννη, δεν ασχολούμαι μόνο με τη Μαύρη Θάλασσα, έχω κι άλλα ενδιαφέροντα για τον. Λοιπόν, καταρχάς να πω ότι σε αυτή την αναστροφή συμμετέχουν φοιτητές μου, και συγγνώμη που το λέω το μου, αλλά το λέω με πολύ περηφάνεια και πολύ χαρά και όχι κομπορινοσύνη. Και τους έχω εδώ ενώπιόν μου και χαίρομαι πάρα πάρα πολύ και νομίζω ότι συμβάλλουν αρκετά στην ανασκαφή σας, κυρία Κόρκα. Οπότε ίσως και η παρουσία μου από το Δημοκρίτιο σήμερα να δικαιολογείται και κάπως έτσι. Άρα σύσσωμα το Δημοκρίτιο και η συνάδελφος εδώ, η κυρία Παπαγιώργοπούλου, έτσι είμαστε παρόντες όπως βλέπετε και συνδράμουμε τα μάλα, όπως έλεγε ένας τηλεοπτικός επίκουρος καθηγητής. Βυζαντινολογία ήταν και όλα. Θα ήθελα να με επιτρέψετε, τώρα ξεκουραζόμαστε γιατί τελειώσαμε και τα λοιπά και τα λοιπά. Θα πάμε από την κατάλαβα κάπου.
Όχι, είναι
μετά το κλώσιο, κοιτάξτε, μετά το κλώσιο. Λοιπόν, θα ήθελα να πω δύο λόγια για την παρουσίαση της κυρίας Μαρίας Κιάρα Μονάκο, αν το λέω καλά. Το θέμα είναι για τον Όμηρο, επειδή έχω κάνει και ένα βιβλίο τελευταία για τον Όμηρο και τη σχέση με την Ανατολή. Μας είπε ότι ο Έκτορας ενδεχομένως να είναι ελληνικής καταγωγής, πιθανότατα και η ολόκληρη ελίτ, η αριστοκρατική της Τρίας να ήταν ελληνικής καταγωγής. Εξ όσων γνωρίζουμε από τα αιχητικά αρχεία, γιατί τα έχω την ευκαιρία να διαβάζω αιχητικά στο πρωτότυπο και όχι μεταφράσεις, και λουβικά και τέλος πάντων. Ξέρουμε ότι αυτή η περιοχή όπου βρίσκεται η Τρία, στα αιχητικά κείμενα αναφέρεται ως Λουβία, δηλαδή Λουβία. Άρα δεν υπάρχει περίπτωση να είναι κάτι άλλο, ενδεχομένως, γι' αυτό και πολλοί συνάδελφοι γράφουν ότι οι Τρώες ενδεχομένως να ήταν λουβιόφωνοι. Ποια είναι η λουβική γλώσσα? Η λουβική γλώσσα είναι μια συγγενής προς τη χετιτική. Υπάρχουν κάποιες διαφοροποίησεις γραμματικές και λεξικολογικές. Κατά βάση είναι συγγενής γλώσσες μεταξύ τους, ινδοευρωπαϊκής σε εισαγωγικά προέλευσης, όπως και η ελληνική. Να μην σας πω τώρα το και σας ταράξω, πως λέγεται στα χετιτικά η λέξη νερό. Water. Water. Στα Βάσερ, έτσι, βόντα, στα βόντα, βόντα, στα σλαβικά και εμείς το λέμε ίδωρ, ίδωρ, τέλος πάντων. Αυτό λοιπόν που λέγαμε, που είπατε για τον Όμηρο, εγώ δεν το ήξερα για τον Έκτορα, ότι μνημονεύεται στις, δεν το είχα δει τουλάχιστον κοντά από τον Έκτορα. Νομίζω ότι Ανατολίτες τι εννοείται, Ανατολίτες που ήρθαν από την Αιγαίος Ανατολή, γιατί έχει τρία της Αιγαίος Ανατολή ή από την Κεντρική Ασία. Πάντως από ό,τι, συγγνώμη, εγώ σας λέω αυτά που διάβασα, για το όνομα του Θεού, για το όνομα του Θεού. Μάλλον όλη η Δυτική Μικρασία και η Κυλικία, η μετέπειτα Κυλική Ενότητα και η Ανατολική Μικρασία ήταν όλοι λουβιόφωνοι κατά το πλείστον. Αργότερα ήρθαν οι Χετέοι με τον Μουρσίλη και τους κατέκτησαν και τους προφανώς μπερδεύτηκε η Χετιδική με τη Λουβική.
Πάντως, αν καταλαβαίνω καλά, και επειδή είπατε για τον Έκτορα, εγώ αυτό ήθελα να επισημάνω περισσότερο. Είπατε ότι ο Έκτορας ενδεχομένως να είναι ελληνικής προέλευσης. Μα το θέμα δεν είναι αν ο Έκτορας είναι ελληνικής προέλευσης ή ο Πρίαμος ή ο Αλέξανδρος, που είπατε πολύ σωστά. Πράγματι, Αλεξάνδρου υπάρχει και ολόκληρη συνθήκη με τον Αλεξάνδρο, με τους Αχιμετίνους, με τους Αχαιούς. Εάν η Αχιλιάδα είναι τελικά η Αχαιή, όλα είναι υποαίρεση, ξέρετε. Λοιπόν, το θέμα είναι πώς προσεγγίζουμε τον Όμηρο. Εάν ο Όμηρος είναι ιστορική πηγή, τότε πράγματι θα μπορούσαμε να πούμε ότι ίσως μιλάμε για μια ελληνοποιημένη, νομίζω ότι χρησιμοποιήσατε τη λέξη Hellenized, αν δεν κάνω λάθος. Ελληνοποιημένη Ελλήνη. Αυτό θα μπορούσε να είναι και σωστό, θα μπορούσε να τελεί και υποαίρεση. Νομίζω όμως ότι ο Όμηρος Προκλήστος δεν είναι μια ιστορική πηγή που μπορούμε να στηριχτούμε για να πούμε ότι ήταν αυτό έτσι ή αλλιώς. Μπορούμε να έχουμε κάποια ψήγματα αλήθεια μες στον Όμηρο, τα οποία μας βοηθούν να προσεγγίσουμε με άλλες πηγές που έχουμε ευτυχώς, έχουμε χαιτητικά έγγραφα επίσημα του κράτους και έχουμε και λουδικά σε συνοητή γραφή, αλλά και σε ιερογλυφική λουδική γραφή. Και μπορούμε να βγάλουμε μερικά συμπεράσματα. Όμως ο Όμηρος, κατά την ταπεινή μου άποψη, δεν ξέρω κύριε Μαυρογιάννη, αν συμφωνήσετε, τουλάχιστον για την Ιλιάδα, νομίζω ότι είναι ένα θρησκευτικό πάνω απ' όλα κείμενο και μετά ποιητικό και ενδεχομένως πολύ πολύ μετά ιστορικό. Τουλάχιστον αυτή είναι η ταπεινή μου άποψη. Με τον Όμηρο ασχολούμαι από μωρό, έχω με την Ιλιάδα, συγγνώμη, έχω μια ιδιαίτερη λατρεία στην Ιλιάδα. Πάντως αυτό για τον Έκτορα είναι πάρα πολύ σημαντικό που πάτε μετά ότι αναφέρεται στις πινακίδες της συνολικής γραφής. Δεν το γνώριζα. Και εκείνο που θα ήθελα επίσης να επισημάνω στον κύριο, στην εισήγηση του κυρίου Μακίδη. Δεν είμαι δυστυχώς, θα ήθελα να είμαι εδώ, αλλά δεν είμαι εδώ. Είπε ότι διάφορα για την Ιλιάδα και για τα Τροϊκά και θα μπορούσαμε αυτό να κλείσουμε έτσι χαριτολογώντας για να ξεκουραστούμε περισσότερο. Η Ιλιάδα και η Οδύσσια, κυρίως όμως η Ιλιάδα, είναι ένα συνονθήλευμα γεγονότων που προηγήθηκαν από τον Όμηρο και τα μάζεψε ο Όμηρος και έκανε αυτό το εξαίσιο πριν από 15.000 στίχων κείμενο. Όμως, έχω την εντύπωση ότι όλα αυτά ξεκινούν πολύ πιο πριν. Γύρω στο 1500 έχουμε μια πολύ σημαντική ιστορία που μας γράφουν οι χιτητικές πινακίδες. Ένα πρικοσύμφωνο. Δεν το γνωρίζουμε πάρα πολύ, δεν ξέρω γιατί δεν το αναφέρουμε. Γύρω στο χρονολογείται γύρω στο 1500 π.Χ. Έχουμε ένα πρικοσύμφωνο μεταξύ μια πριγκίπισσας από την Αχιλιάδα, μάλλον από κάποιο μυκηναϊκό κέντρο, ενδεχομένως ίσως να είναι και η Θήβα, και όχι οι Μυκήνες. Και από την άλλη, ένα παλικάρι που θέλει να παντρευτεί με αυτήν την κοπέλα, την πριγκίπισσα, την Ελληνίδα, από τη Χιτητική Αυλή. Και ως πρίκα δίνουν οι Χεταίοι στην πριγκίπισσα, δηλαδή στον πατέρα της, δίνουν τα νησιά του νότιου ανατολικού Αιγαίου, δηλαδή Ρόδο κτλ. Εκεί, κοντά στη Μύλητο. Ο γάμος δεν επετεύχθη και τα νησιά τα ζητούν πίσω οι Χεταίοι. Και έτσι ξεκινά, τουλάχιστον θα λέγαμε, μια πρώτη ιστορία σύγκρουση, συγκρουσιακή ανάμεσα στους δύο λαούς. Αυτό δεν το είπε ο κ. Μακίδης, ενδεχομένως θα το ξέφυγε. Απλά να ξέρουμε ότι από πολύ νωρίς αρχίζουν αυτές οι ιστορίες, οι συγκρούσεις μεταξύ Μυκηναίων και Χεταίων. Αυτά. Ευχαριστώ.
Ευχαριστούμε πολύ τον κύριο Πετρόπουλο Ηλία και την κυρία Λίλα Δετσάπης. Υπάρχουν εικασίες, όπως ξέρω, πολλές στην ερμηνεία τέτοιων πηγών. Σίγουρα η αρχαιολογική τεκμηρίωση σφραγίζει το ποιο είναι το πραγματικό. Αυτό δεν σημαίνει ότι δεν πρέπει να συνεχίζει οι διερεύνες και σε βάθος συσχετισμοί των μεταπομπηλών πηγών και όταν λέω πηγών, όχι μόνο των ιστορικών στοιχείων, αλλά και των μυθολογικών. Όπως και ο κ. Μαλόπουλος είπε, μύθος δεν είναι αυτό. Όπως συνηθίζουμε να λέμε μύθος, έχει ένα πίσω από το μύθο ένα πολιτικό. Άρα λοιπόν αξίζονται αυτές οι διερευνήσεις και νομίζω το τρίτυχο της, που είναι και το τίτλος του συνεδρίου, τρία τεμέα Ρώμη, διεγείρει όλους μας διεπιστημονικά και πολυεπιστημονικά σε τέτοιες αναζητήσεις που όπως φαίνεται στο τέλος της ημερίδος αναδύονται, έτσι, και θα ήταν χρήσιμο εφόσον βγουν πρακτικά να μην αναφέρονται μόνο τα γραπτά κείμενα των ομιλητών, αλλά αν είναι δυνατόν και οι συζητήσεις που έγιναν. Συμπληρώνουν και βοηθούν πάρα πολύ στην ολοκλήρωση αυτού του συνεδρίου. Νομίζω ότι δεν υπάρχει άλλη ερώτηση, ή μάλλον θα έλεγα επειδή έχουμε αργήσει πολύ. Short, very short. Short, OK.
And so I'm very hesitant to say that a very serious scholar, because he was a scholar, as Dionysius was a
scholar.
Moreover, I wish also to state that, as far as I know at least, there are not written inscriptions have been found on Troy. This information was provided to me by the very renowned Mycenaean scholar Penelope Magioi, who is the greatest probably scholar
of Ayala in Asia Minor. Ευχαριστώ πολύ για την πληροφορία. Thank you for this information. But I believe that still, πιστεύω ότι αυτό το ζήτημα που συζητάμε γλωσσολογικά, αρχαιολογικά, ιστορικά, μυθολογικά, δεν είναι μια εύκολη υπόθεση και γι' αυτό άλλωστε γίνονται και τα συνέδρια, ώστε να βοηθούν τον ερευνητή να έχει μια πιο ολοκληρωμένη άποψη, γενικά και να το μεταδίδει στο Ακαδημία και να γίνεται αποδεκτή. Θα ήθελα να ευχαριστήσω όλους τους ομιλητές αυτής της τελευταίας συνεδρίας για την ενδιαφέρουσα συζήτηση που έγινε επίσης. Να συγχαρώ τους ομιλητές, να συγχαρώ αυτούς που μείναν ακόμα σήμερα μαζί μας, όλους σας δηλαδή, και την κυρία Κόρκα για την όμορφη αυτή ημερίδα που συνέλαβε αυτό το κόνσεπτ, το οποίο είμαι βέβαιος και το είδε και η ίδια, ότι θα είναι αρχή πολλών εκπλήξεων και ανακαλύψεων στο εγγύς μέλλον. Ένα θερμόπληρο και ευχαριστώ για τους ομιλητές και την κυρία Κόρκα. Ο ρόλος μας τέλειωσε εδώ, οπότε θα καλέσω στο βήμα τους φίλους της Αρχαίας Αθηναίας, την κυρία Κόρκα, για να κλείσω το συνέδριο.